हाय,
या
बोलो बोलो बोलो। अरे
क्या बोलूं, आई डोंट इवन नो हाउ टू व्हाट टू से। दिस वाज 12th नवंबर। आई वाज आई जस्ट स्टार्टेड वर्किंग फॉर द डे, नॉट बेरली, लाइक आई स्टार्टेड अराउंड 10, एंड इट वाज एक्चुअली क्वाइट अ यू नो डिस्ट्रैक्टिंग डे फॉर मी, बिकॉज अ लॉट वाज हैपनिंग। अ कलीग mother passed away, and then somebody was going for the funeral from my office. Philippines had a typhoon that day, so we have people working around the globe, and we've got people working from Philippines, and they could not log in. And so I was very distracted with all of that because they kept calling and saying, "Oh yeah, look into this and look into that." So about 10:55 a.m., I got a call from somebody saying, "I'm calling from Bank of Baroda, and we need to do your KYC again, and your account will become frozen if you don't complete it or whatever."
Okay.
And with my mind being so distracted, I actually was like, "Yeah, okay, fine. So what do I do?" And he also was so convincing because he actually had my PAN card and Aadhaar card number, which he read out to me. So, I mean, I know what has happened is unfortunate, and it's wrong on my part or stupid on my part at some point, because I helped him do whatever he did.
Right.
The fact that somebody already has my Aadhaar card and PAN card number as it is, I mean, he read it out to me.
Right.
Was very convincing that he's actually calling from the bank. So he's like, basically he's like, "You use mobile banking?" I'm like, "Yeah." He's like, "Have you changed your password recently?" Then he's like, "Okay, so I will help you update." Then he asked me if you've changed your mobile banking application and PIN, MPIN basically. And I'm like, "No, I have not done it recently." He's like, "You know they keep saying you're supposed to change it every 3-4 months or whatever for security reasons." Now this is something again that they, I know that the banks say, but I was like, yeah, I know, you know, type. So he basically was like, "Okay, I'll give you the MPIN, you put this." Now what happens is, when usually when you start an account with when you get into MPIN for the first time, the MPIN is system generated, which comes on your phone. And it didn't strike me even at that point that the MPIN is something which will give him access into my account. So he told me, "Take this number and put this number in."
So he gave you an MPIN.
He gave me the MPIN.
Okay,
so
and
I even asked him, and he's like, "Arey, MPIN hai na, application PIN is still going to be yours." You know, basically there is a two-step verification. One is the application PIN, one is the MPIN. Application PIN gets you in there, and MPIN is helps you, basically it's like your transaction password.
All right.
He got me to change that.
So wait.
And then
did he ask for your card number or any such details?
No card number.
He didn't ask for any details.
No.
He straight gave you a number. He didn't take any information from you. He gave you a number to enter.
Correct.
Okay, this is new.
No, actually he did not generate it. So basically MPIN is the first time when you set up the MPIN, it is system generated, because when you're trying to set it up, it says this is your MPIN, you get it and you change it.
But how did
so
he
have
an
I was
MPIN
already
which he
using
dictated?
It. No.
But he dictated your MPIN.
I already had a working MPIN. You don't need to update the MPIN, change it.
Wait, you understand? Wait. Yeah,
basically,
I get it.
Yeah. So he made me believe that it was a system generated one, but it was not. It was a general MPIN he wanted me to put so he can get access into it. So if I did not change the MPIN, my MPIN would still work. It's not like it would not work.
Okay, I understand. Okay, now let me get this. I'm a bit slow.
So
now
So it is like
someone calls you and says, "Hey, listen, Krish, your email ID, you put in this email, this
password,
and
yes,
then I change
exactly.
my password to that password, and that
exactly.
is the message."
Yeah. And then I'm like, okay, so when I questioned it, this is the answer he gave me, that application and password is still yours, no? MPIN password I'm telling you to change. So I was also like, ha, theek hai, fine, maybe, you know, because I didn't realize that MPIN is what exactly at that point, because again, like I said, I was distracted and all that. And with a lot happening, I was just like, theek hai, maybe, you know, and I did it. And then he said, oh, aapko ek message aaya rahega. And I'm like, message? He's like, हाँ आपको एक रेफरेंस नंबर आया रहेगा आपके फोन पे, आप जरा चेक कर लीजिए. I said, okay. So, you know, this also, it was not very clear. He was like, reference number. So, there were three numbers that came in. One was an OTP. One was a reference number in particular, like a reference ID. And one was another number starting with the alphabet K. So first he told me reference ID आया रहेगा. So I told him हाँ reference number, reference ID आया है and it was some 8 or 10 digit number starting with 68 something something. I'm like हाँ ये कुछ आया है 8-10 digit का. He said नहीं नहीं वो नहीं, दूसरा एक है. I'm like एक दूसरा आया है जो K के साथ चालू होता है, you know, and he said हाँ हाँ नहीं नहीं वो नहीं, एक 6 digit का number आया रहेगा. Getting into the OTP.
Right.
6 digit का number जो है, I'm like, ये आपको क्यों लगेगा? He's like, नहीं आप यहाँ पे बताएंगे तो मैं आपका यहाँ से KYC अपडेट कर दूंगा, you know, कुछ प्रॉब्लम नहीं होगा. So I started with the number and I don't remember completing the number.
OTP, you just started with the number.
I think so. Honestly, it's very vague because unfortunately I do not have the call logs.
Okay.
So I started with the number and I'm like, नहीं OTP तो क्यों लगना चाहिए आपको, because you are तो just doing a updation ना, you तो already have my details. And he was like, हाँ हाँ ठीक है अभी बराबर है, आप 2 मिनट रुकिए, आपका अपडेट करके आपको बताता हूँ मैं. And he just put me on a hold and I started getting messages of transactions happening back to back, back to back, back to back. It went down to 10 transactions and a huge lump sum of amount. In between that, towards the end, basically, I got 2 messages of amounts credited into my account, which I didn't realize were my FDs being broken.
Oh,
because
damn.
Bank of Baroda has an option of instant pre-closure of FDs.
Damn.
So he broke those and he immediately started doing a transaction from there as well, from which he managed to do 1 transaction and after that I managed to cut him off. While all this is happening, I'm calling up the customer service of Bank of Baroda and I'm telling them that there is an issue. After he finished verification and all that, whatever, I'm telling him there is a problem in my account. Somebody has gotten into my account. I need you to block all transactions. But this guy is like, oh, okay, I'll block your debit card. I'm like, no, I want you to block my entire account. I want you to freeze it completely. He's like, okay, I will block your UPI. I'm like, can you just block my account? And while this is happening, there are more transactions happening.
He's like, okay,
I have done it. And I'm like, if you have done it, why am I still getting transaction messages? So basically, he was pretty useless. And I, while all that was happening, I was trying to get into net banking because my mobile banking was obviously not working. He was already in the account and he kicked me off. So I'm trying to log into net banking. My password doesn't work. So I had to do a forget password, this, that. By then, I lost a lot of time. Somehow I managed to change the password, get in and deactivate MPIN. As soon as I did that, the transaction stopped.
Okay, Basically, this was a time lapse of how long? You struggled for how long?
This entire struggle, actually the first 2-3 minutes I froze. My fingers were just shaking and I was in shock. I was in bad trauma, like I couldn't handle what was happening. So the first 2-3 minutes just went like that. I didn't know what to do. Eventually, I got in. It took about 12 to 13, 14 minutes maybe. And in that much time, he removed a whole lump sum of money, which is, you know, that was my salary account. And that had the amount which, I mean, I could have done so much more with that money.
Lost a couple of lakhs?
Yes, I have. And again, you know, with all that, and then I'm like panicking, and I'm like, I head towards the bank. I try and get somebody there. I'm like, while I'm getting to the bank, I have a fall. So I sprain my leg, and I'm limping and getting into the bank. And this guy's like, okay, haan, baitho. And he's like, haan, kya hua? Okay. And while that is happening, he's talking to two other people, three other people who are standing there. I mean, this is an emergency situation, and you're just like, haan, okay, whatever, taking your own sweet time. And he's like, okay, idhar se udhar jao, approval le lo, wahan pe account ye block karo.
Yeah, but you had already blocked, right? You had already blocked it. So what is remaining
technically,
now?
Technically, they had only blocked my UPI. And when I get there, it's any bank, debit card block karo. I'm like, okay, just block whatever the hell you want. Right now, I just need to keep my account secured. So first, I was like, okay, just freeze the account till I figure out what to do. Because I don't want any other, I didn't know if there was any other way for him to get try and get in or whatever. I do not feel safe leaving my money in that bank anymore. Even though I have changed the passwords and whatever, everything else, but this is a shock to me. I have worked very hard for this money, and given the current situation, it's, you know, if nobody, like, people are not having jobs, people are losing money like this, this is not a nice way.
Yeah.
So with all that, I'm like, can you just do whatever you have to do, just block my account for, freeze my account for now till I figure out what I want to do next.
Right.
In that time, I need you to give, so I'm like, tell me, what do I do? So he makes me write a statement, like a letter to the bank saying this has happened with the amounts and all that. So then they took those amounts, they took the letter, then they sent an email to the IMPS department, because this guy did IMPS, so it is instant, doesn't waste time at all.
So he did IMPS to new accounts, to different accounts of his?
There were total about 5 accounts, if I'm not mistaken, and he did like 1 transaction, 2 transactions, 3 transactions to multiple accounts.
Okay, I have a question,
yeah.
I have a question. See, when I do IMPS, if I add a new beneficiary,
no,
my bank gives me a lag of at least half an hour before that beneficiary is confirmed.
Yes, but you're talking about private banks.
Yeah.
Okay. So now what has happened is in the mobile banking IMPS section, you don't need to add a beneficiary. You are instantly transferring the money to the account.
This goes to all banks, or you're talking only about Bank of Baroda or some such bank?
I don't have any other government banks to bank with, so I'm sorry, I don't have an answer to that.
You don't
but
have
this
an
is
answer.
And actually, I have not even done an IMPS on Bank of Baroda. I don't remember doing one.
Right.
So I don't know, but obviously, I do not have those accounts in my name.
Right. Because IMPS, if they add a beneficiary and that's half an hour, you know, it prevents this kind of instant scam from happening.
Exactly. This is what the problem is with a government bank. I think they basically... So the thing is, when the government wanted us to go digital per se, they're like, oh yeah, you can send money in an instant. You can send it to mobile numbers, you can send it to banks, you know, whatever you want. And obviously, sending it to a mobile number would be a risky situation, because they will be caught with that mobile numbers wherever they're sending.
Right.
Now, in the bank situation that we're having right now, with the current, you know, because of COVID or whatever, a lot of accounts were opened digitally. So they did not do a proper address verification.
KYC and all. Address verification.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Now, so that was the other thing I learned while the whole thing was going on. So let's go back to what happened at the bank, because that was something which was a terrible situation. Here I'm freaking out. My money has been, you know, just disappeared from my account in a matter of 10 to 15 minutes. And this, the kind of, you know, I was expecting at least the bank should understand that if somebody's money is going, they should do something firsthand to try and do something about it. But he's like, oh, fill this form. Then he's talking to 10 other people. I've told him I've broken my leg. He's like, go to the other place and give him the last 5 digits of your account number.
Yeah, you had hurt your leg, right? You hurt your leg in the process.
Yes, I fell down and I sprained my leg so badly that I wanted to cry, but I could not even do that because I had to get this thing sorted out.
Mm.
And I was in pain all day.
Okay, so you're limping around and they're not supporting you, they're not helping you, they're saying go from here to there and there to the other place.
Yeah, I mean, they did help me eventually, but I mean, the process was stupid.
Okay.
So they're like, go to the other person, go there, give him the last 5 digits of your account number, he will freeze your account. Then again, he's like, okay, do this, give this letter. Then he sends a letter to the IMPS. Saying, okay, these are the transactions, give me the thing. He's like, you do one thing, you want to leave? I have added you in copy in the email. Whenever they reply, you will get it. Now,
You will get what?
The list of the accounts of where the money was transferred.
Okay, so it was also, they didn't give you the list immediately.
No, apparently the bank doesn't get the list immediately. Because it was done an IMPS transfer.
How can that
They had to get it. So there are multiple ways, right? If it was done normal net banking, I think they would have gotten the information. But IMPS apparently is a different department. So they had to send out an email to the IMPS department, tell them to give the transaction details, and only then we would get it.
So the IMPS, so it is not a smooth, seamless operation. They have, like, within the whole bank, there is this, send a letter to this department, send a letter to that department. There's a bureaucracy within the department.
Yes.
Oh, God.
So, while that was coming, he's like, you can go, you will get the email, and you can just, once you get that, I'm like, okay, now what to do? First of all, the most shocking thing to me was, as soon as I told him that something like this has happened, he told me, this is the first time I'm hearing about this.
He says he's the first time he's hearing about this.
Yes, he's like, ye pehli baar hua hai. And I'm like looking at him like, are you serious? Like,
nonsense.
How is that even possible?
Like, nonsense.
Are you in the bank for the first time in your life or what is happening? But anyways, I just was not in the frame of mind to sit and, you know, argue with him at that particular time. I just needed to get my work done.
Bank of Baroda seems to have been compromised in some way. Because I don't think it's a coincidence that the audio that I posted yesterday on my blog, on my
was
YouTube,
was also Bank of Baroda.
Was also Bank of Baroda.
I heard that.
You know?
And I heard that and then I got in touch with you because I was like, there is something wrong somewhere.
So Bank of Baroda has been merged with Dena Bank and I think one more other bank. I wonder if this has created a kind of a security hole in the system for...
I am assuming so, and I really feel unsafe keeping my money there. And with all that running around and all, and then my brother was constantly trying to, because he was not, he couldn't be there with me, he was like constantly trying to help me out and guide me what to do. So he is like, you know what, just do one thing, whatever money you have left, just transfer it to another bank account for now, you know, and then we'll see what to do, you know. It was just a safety concern for me because I'm like, again, if I leave money in there, I don't know when this person will try and get in again.
Mm.
Whatever it is, even if I blocked him out, but I'm scared. So I tell them, okay, now unfreeze my account. So they make me fill in another form saying, okay, yeah, you want to unfreeze it? Okay, fill in this form. I unfreeze it. Then I'm like, okay, now what? He's like, okay, go back over there and give your last 5 digits. And he will unfreeze the account for you again. I mean, this is a ridiculous shit show. Like, I don't even know how they function. If one person is handling it, why can't one person handle it? And if you know, I told you I had a fall. Why can't you just help me take care of this?
Right.
And
why
again,
go from
again,
here to there? Hmm.
Exactly. And then I'm like, you know what? I want to just transfer. He's like, okay, but how are you going to... I'm like, give me a demand draft or something because I have no other way to do it right now.
Hmm.
So I mean, or just do a online NEFT transfer from your end because I cannot do it right now. I don't have access.
Why can't you do it?
Because I never transferred money from within my account. So if I'm transferring out anyway, there's a limit in how much I can send out in one day, right? So first of all, I would wait for 30 minutes to do the transfer. To put in the name. I don't know how long it takes, 30 minutes. And then because I would have to do a normal, you know, transfer, not an IMPS. So I would have to wait for 30 minutes for that to happen. And then after that also there is a limit on how much I can transfer. Plus whatever, I was like, I don't have the energy or the strength to deal with it. I'm like, why don't you all do it for me, you know, from your NEFT. So they make me fill in another form. After I fill that form, I go back on the counter. The person who was helping me out, she went on lunch. Okay, agreed, understandable. So this other guy like, acha, ye bhi bharna. I'm like, why didn't you give me that before? I'm limping. Can't you guys see? So again, I go back. Again, I fill it up. And then I'm like, okay, here. So then he's like, हाँ आप वो काउंटर पे जाइए और वहां से जाके ऑथराइजेशन कराइए, वेरिफिकेशन कराइए. सो आई गो टू अनदर काउंटर, ही इज डूइंग द वेरिफिकेशन, ही गिव्स इट बैक टू मी. आई गो बैक अगेन टू दैट काउंटर, आई लाइक ओके हियर नाउ कैन यू प्लीज डू द ट्रांसफर.
एंड यू ट्रांसफर टू अनदर बैंक?
यस, एनईएफटी और आरटीजीएस, आई डोंट नो, व्हाटएवर दे डिड. सो दैट ही टेक्स इट फ्रॉम मी एंड आई डोंट नो वेदर ही वाज स्लीपिंग और इफ ही his own world, he takes it from me and he puts it in the bottom of a pile of what he is working on. And I look at him like, hello, do you even know what has happened? I'm in an emergency, you know, like you're going to do this after you finish everything. Can you please transfer it right now? And then he's like, oh, okay, fine. So then he does the transfer. I'm like, meko the message nahi aaya, transfer nahi hua. He's like, nahi madam, ho gaya. Then I realized somehow that the SMS thing is off. So he said, अच्छा वो काउंटर पे जाइए, उसको उनको बोलिए वो आपका चालू कर देंगे. So again I go over there. He said, आपका अकाउंट नंबर. So I give him my account details. He said, हाँ मैंने यहाँ से किया है, आप एक काम कीजिए, वो दूसरे काउंटर पे जाइए, वो चालू कर देंगे, वो हो जाएगा. So again I'm going to another counter just to get that activated. I don't even understand what is happening. They made me block my debit card. So then I'm like, okay, now a debit card. He's like, आपको दूसरा कार्ड आ जाएगा, आपको नया डेबिट कार्ड के लिए भरना पड़ेगा फॉर्म. So I had to fill in another form for that.
Sent all your money to a different bank.
Yeah, but I haven't closed the account because I need to keep that. I need to keep the account there at least till we figure out everything. I cannot just close the account right now.
Okay. Because so you still need the debit card?
This is a fraud case. So
right.
I cannot just close the account. I need to have the account at least there for me to have any kind of
investigations and all that.
Yeah, because if I close it completely, they'll be like, "Arey, account hi band hai, toh kuch back end hai nahi kuch."
I understand.
You know?
I agree.
So I cannot just close the account. So I'm like, I just kept a minimum balance and I transferred the rest of the money to another branch.
Do they have any kind of procedure for investigating what happened and any kind of police complaint procedure or anything like that?
Yeah, so I asked him, abhi kya karna hai, what is the procedure? I'm asking the guy at the bank. So he said, ek kaam kijiye, ek baar ye jo list aa jayega jahan pe amount gaya hai, aap wo leke bank mein chale, police station crime branch mein chale jaiye. Cyber branch or whatever, if they have a cyber, all police stations have a
cyber crime branch.
Yes. So I was like, can I go to any police station or do I need to go to the one closest to the bank? So he's like, nahi, aap kahin pe bhi ja sakte hain. So while the transfer was happening, so I asked him, abhi, so then what? He's like, just take the letter, take the accounts where the money was transferred to. And you can go to the bank, to the police station, and you can file in your complaint. I'm like, okay. I'm like, what happened to the IMPS? Why haven't they replied yet? Now, this is over an hour. I'm sitting over there. They're like, ja sakte ho, aapko mail aa jayega. And I'm like, no, I cannot just leave. Go and do what? I'm not going to gallivant. I'm stressed.
So, this is the same morning. This is the same morning you are there.
Same morning. I rushed there within an hour's time.
So, this is around 12 o'clock or 1 o'clock when they are saying?
12:30, I reached there. 12:45. Because there was a lot of traffic and everything happening. And then this entire thing went on and I did not leave the bank till at least 3:15, 3:30.
Okay.
I have left the bank at 3:30-ish. No, maybe 3:15. Because he's like, aap ja sakte ho. And then the email came with the account details. But it did not come to me. It came to him only. They did not add me in copy.
They did not send the email to you.
Yes, the IMPS department did not add me in copy. They only sent it to the bank. So if I would have left from there, then what? Go back again or try to call them?
Yeah.
Because when I tried to call the bank's numbers in the morning when all the entire scenario took place, I couldn't get to any of those numbers.
Mm.
So I was like, I'm not leaving from here till I have the list. So why actually the thing is, it was 3 something already and I had the fall around 12 something. Mm. So I was already in a lot of pain. I didn't nurse my leg. My leg was like throbbing at that point already.
Mm.
So my actual plan was to go home and, you know, put something on my leg so that I can at least have it get some support or whatever.
Mm.
But then considering the time, Kunal suggested that you please go to the police station first because, you know, it will be quicker. You
correct.
Lose a lot of time.
And time is of essence because they will be
exactly.
emptying, you know, their footprints.
More than the emptying, it was Thursday, 12th November, and the following next 4 days was a holiday.
Oh, yeah.
Bank holiday because it was just before Diwali. So it was very essential for me to go to the police station at that point itself.
Right.
So I reached the police station. I tell the officer on duty whatever happened. So he was actually quite supportive. I mean, he had to understand what happened and all that. And I give him the list of where the accounts, of all the accounts that were. And mind you, like from what I have heard in these cases, usually they use accounts which are out of Mumbai. So it will mostly be like a UP or, you know, Indore or very secluded Gao cases usually. You know, either Gujarat, like how in your video, you know, YouTube video had.
Yeah.
Or in, you know, somewhere very, in a small village.
Mm.
But these accounts were all Thane, Ambernath, Kalyan.
Oh. Okay.
And it was all government banks as well.
Oh.
And so the police first called up the bank, told them that there is a fraud happened, giving them the situation, telling them that give me your email address, I'm going to send you an official email, I need you to do a debit freeze on all the accounts, basically.
On all the accounts?
On the accounts.
All those accounts.
The fraud, all those accounts. So each and every bank we called up and we had that done. First step.
It was the cop who did this, is it?
Correct. Because obviously I cannot call up and say that, right?
Right.
So the cop calls up, he tells them this has happened. I need you to put a debit freeze right away on these accounts. I'm sending an official email. Give me your email address. After he sent the emails to all the concerned banks, he recalled those banks up, asking them if the KYC was digital or regular full KYC, and whether the how much money is in the account, and if they have already done the process of doing a debit freeze on all those on the accounts in each bank. So this also took quite some time, but we did all that. And after that he was like, okay, now all this is done. So I asked him so there were two things. One is he asked me as soon as I got there, if it happened at almost 11 o'clock in the morning, around 11 o'clock in the morning, why have you come so late? So I was like, I came late because I was at the bank. I got the list and I came to you right away.
Right.
So he's like, okay, good. The second thing, when I asked him, what is the procedure from here and how does it go about? He's like, aap lucky ho, aap jaldi aa gaye hai. Many people come after 2-3 days.
Damn. Yeah, that is true. Even you would have done that, you know, you would have gone because you had sprained your ankle, you might have gone home and rested.
I wouldn't have gone after 2-3 days. I would have gone the same day within an hour or so, but I would have been late given the cut time of the bank.
Right.
So, with all that into consideration, then I asked him, what is the procedure now? He's like, okay, so now the procedure is first we need to find these people. So they are.
Find the thief, okay.
Yes. So they are going to, you know, they are going to get the KYC of these people from the bank. Which hopefully they already have started the process, because banks started from Tuesday, today being a Saturday. I'm hoping something must have started with. So he did, because I met him after a few days, because to pick up my FIR report, and he said he's already sent a letter to the bank asking them for the KYC and all the details. Also, he asked the bank at that point itself, where has the money been withdrawn from? Because a lot of the money was already withdrawn from ATM.
Yeah, I can imagine. So they would do it very quickly.
Yes. So his question to them was, where, which area? So I think a lot of it was somewhere around a petrol pump ATM. I don't remember if the location was mentioned, but they said they did mention that it was some petrol pump on some road they had mentioned, and it was some ATM over there. So I think that's how they have removed most of the money.
From all the accounts, it was withdrawn from the same one ATM.
I'm not aware of that.
Okay.
But all of them did say that it was some petrol pump ATM.
Okay.
So it could be the same one, could be multiple ones. No idea. So, I asked him what the process would be. He said first we need to find the people.
Okay. I think then petrol pump could be one possible explanation for petrol pump is, a guy in a jacket and a crash helmet is difficult to identify. Every guy in a jacket and crash helmet looks the same.
Exactly.
You know?
Exactly. So even if they have a camera set up, it's of no use. Because
it is of no use, and it looks very normal for a guy with a crash helmet to step into a petrol pump ATM. Whereas elsewhere, at least you know whether the guy is bald, uska baal kitna hai, wo ganja hai, chota hai, nata hai, kya hai, kuch to dikhega.
Right.
Even if he is wearing a mask. But yahan par to kuch bhi, there are no identifiers. Maybe that is the reason.
Exactly.
Okay.
So first step will be looking for these people, getting their information. Second step is looking for these people. After he gets them also, they will do an investigation. And after that also, I'm like, okay, but what about the money? If there is any money, how do I get it back? Like, even if you want to get the money back, it's not like we can just transfer it from one account to the other account. You need to put an appeal to the court. Then the court is going to ask us if it is okay. Then you will go ahead to the banks to transfer the money to you. So this is another additional expanded.
So court will have to send the money back to you after. I mean, the bank will have to send the money back to you only if the court directs it. Yeah.
Yes. Yes. Once the police officer says it's all okay and can do it.
Okay, but they managed to stop any of the debits from happening, or do you have any information on that? Like how much was taken and how much is stopped and frozen?
I think 25% is there in the bank account.
25% of what was stolen?
Yes.
Is there in the bank account, and 75% has been withdrawn by ATM card?
Yes. Between 20 and 25% is in the account.
Okay.
So now it's just hoping and praying. But even then, I don't know, because they can just say paisa nahi hai, and it'll be like, okay, what are you going to do then? Like, what can you do? So, I don't know. Let's see. It's just praying and hoping and wishing that something good comes out of it.
And when this rapid fire melting of your FDs started happening, did all your FDs go off, or did only some go off and then you managed to stop it?
Oh, no. So there were two FDs, and he broke both, and he did one transaction. So he removed a part of the FD, but I managed to cut him off right after that.
Okay.
So he didn't completely wipe it off, but he did wipe out a big sum.
On hindsight,
yeah.
Is there something you could have done which was faster and which was better? You know, which would have been more effective?
I'm sure it would have. Calling up the customer service, I should have just tried to log into my net banking account right away and deactivated my MPIN. That was the first thing I should have been able to do.
So rather but than calling up customer service, you should have first deactivated your MPIN.
Definitely. Because MPIN was where he's got access from. Customer service is useless. For anything in life, customer service is useless. First-hand experience. So if you just get into the account, block the MPIN, the person is out of the account.
Right. So you use the computer to log in, is it?
Your
PC.
Agree. Yes, completely. My only problem is my fingers were shaking so much I couldn't get the password correct.
Right.
Because I was in state of shock. And it took me more than 4 to 5 days to just get over it. No, I'm not completely over it even now. I'm still in that shock, but I'm still a little better. 4 days I just said I'm not going to work also because I could not. My mind just went back and forth on that only.
I can imagine.
It's a big blunder that has
happened. It makes you feel very insecure. It makes you feel totally unsafe.
Absolutely. What, you don't feel like doing anything. I'm trying to do one thing. My mind is not focused on anything I'm doing. Even now, back and forth, thoughts come. At this particular point, any message that comes on my phone, I get a split heart attack at every point.
Oh God.
Because I am like, abhi kya hua? Any message that I see, KYC, uske to pehle hi jaati hai meri. I was distracted. It was my mistake. I agree completely on that. But I have worked too hard to just let that go. I have to do something about it. And I am definitely going to put an email to the bank because if the bank says it's your fault, I will say when I'm calling up your customer service is useless. I could have saved at least some amount of money from that lump sum amount of money that I've lost. If that person understood what I'm trying to tell him and just froze my account at that particular point.
Right.
At least 2 or 3 transactions minimum would have been saved.
Right.
The bank cannot put this completely on the person, man. They have to take some responsibility of when somebody calls in, train your staff well enough so that they know what they have to do. When somebody is saying, freeze the account completely, you are saying, oh, debit card block karenge, UPI block karenge. Then, oh, I forgot the best thing. He's telling me, do one thing, you block your net banking. I'm like, how do you want me to do that? He said, just go put your password wrong 5 times on net banking.
What?
Yes.
Say again.
Block your net banking.
Huh? How?
I told him to freeze my account.
Mm.
He's telling me, block your net banking. I said, okay, how do you want me to do that? He's telling me, go into your net banking, put in your password wrong 5 times, it will get blocked.
Okay.
So, he wants me to he's not only freezing my account, he didn't do that, but he wants me to block my net banking now, but the person is moving money through UPI from mobile banking. So what is the point of blocking net banking?
It would remove your last possible access to your this thing. Okay.
Exactly.
But wait, just a question. If you block your net banking, does it also block your mobile banking?
No, it doesn't. It only blocks my net banking. It doesn't do anything else. It doesn't freeze my account. It doesn't block mobile banking. It doesn't do anything.
Okay. Okay.
So, I'm sitting over there and I'm like, you know what, you're useless. Thank you for nothing. And I hung up on him and I'm like, let me just get into my account because this is a waste of time.
Hmm.
So, calling up customer service is the stupidest thing you can do.
This is a waste of time. Okay.
It's a complete waste of time. First, you'll get the IVR, then you have to press button, which one IVR, which one.
Right.
By the time, then you get somebody on the phone, then they will do verification, address, bhi hai aapka. After all that, then you tell him, ye karna hai, but he'll understand something else.
Okay. So first idea would be to go to, so again, just to clarify, the best thing you can do is to go access through your net banking and
go into your MPIN, deactivate your MPIN.
Deactivate your MPIN.
That is the quickest way to stop it. Unfortunately, if somebody gets into your account, first thing is when somebody calls for KYC, you tell them to go to hell. If somebody asks me, should I bank with a government bank, I would say just don't bank with a government bank. At this point, none.
Yeah, no, all government banks, not necessarily. I mean, maybe, may not be.
Maybe, but I mean, why would they have an option for instant pre-closure of FD? I mean, how stupid.
Yeah,
I mean,
that's
People need money. I know people need money, but at least keep an hour gap or something like that.
Right. What is this instant pre-closure and,
or
you know.
Or they should just, one more thing is, what I don't understand is, if it was HDFC or any other private bank, from my experience with HDFC at least,
yeah.
You know, when you do one, so basically a bank is supposed to study how a customer banks.
Normally pattern, your normal pattern of
behavior.
Exactly. Right.
So I don't do a lot of banking. I don't
right.
do a lot of mobile banking.
Right.
Right? I'm very minimal on it.
Right.
All of a sudden, there are transactions happening one after the other in a span of 10 minutes.
Right.
The bank doesn't realize something is wrong.
There has to be a circuit breaker.
If this was HDFC, I know the minute the third transaction would have taken place, the bank would have called me and said, are you doing this?
Correct. HDFC, I have also noticed, by the way, because I have done some bank transactions. If you do something that is not characteristic, I think it just plain freezes. The other transactions won't go through at all.
It doesn't freeze. It doesn't freeze. Yeah, it stops the payment at that point.
Yeah.
Because somebody will call you up right away saying, there are these transactions happening. Are you doing it?
Right. Correct.
Because I was trying to do something at one point a couple years ago.
Mm.
And I think it was a big amount, like 30,000 something.
Mm.
Or whatever.
Mm.
I was doing once, it didn't go through, and the second time I got a call right away saying, we think this is a fraud, are you doing it?
Right.
So why don't all the banks have something like this?
I agree.
Where they see the pattern and they're seeing, like, this person has a minimum balance of so much in the account for so long.
Absolutely.
All of a sudden, why is the person removing so much money at one time?
Absolutely, absolutely.
Why didn't this alert the bank at that point itself and stop it after the second or third transaction?
Right.
Why did it have to go to 10 transactions? Even then, they are not doing it.
Absolutely.
The account went to zero. The person removed the last amount and got into FD and started breaking FD and withdrawing money from there. Even then, the bank is not getting any alert. I mean, what kind
Very
of bank
strange.
Is
this? I totally agree. In fact, this, you know, makes you vulnerable to yet one more situation, which is a guy physically holding you hostage. You know, like with
yeah.
a gun or a knife, and saying, okay, transfer everything to these accounts. Now, there have to be circuit breakers and there have to be cooling off periods. So that if you do something which is very uncharacteristic, like trying to empty out your account, it should freeze. It should just stop, and very quickly, before 10% happens, it should start, as you said, it should
exactly.
start querying, or it should start giving cooling off periods and, you know, half an hour, 1 hour, half a day, so that you can be held hostage.
I completely agree. I also think that what they should do is, they should have a time span. You cannot do more than one IMPS transaction within 20 minutes.
Yes.
After 20 minutes, you let a second transaction happen.
Correct.
Let the people wait. What is the emergency? Who
Correct. What
die?
Is the emergency? I totally agree. There has to be some security set up here. This is ridiculous.